Good afternoon. Hope everybody is there after having a lunch. Now in this session, we will discuss about the different sensors which are being used in the engines and in automotive, their principle of working, their characteristics. I will develop on all this theoretical aspect of these sensors, and at the same time then we would like to discuss all the practical aspects, and we have a test bench here where we will discuss about each and every sensor, how it operates, what are the design parameters for that, and even I will discuss the location of the sensors where it is fitted in the vehicle. Let's start with the manifold absolute pressure sensor. As the name indicates, that this sensor is used to measure the vacuum basically in the intake manifold, because in the intake manifold the pressure is always less than atmospheric, so that's why we call it absolute pressure sensors. Absolute means it starts from the zero, so 0 to 100 is 0 to 100 kilopascal. 100 kilopascal is equal to 1 atmospheric. And the principle of operation of this sensor is piezoresistive type. It has a Bridgestone type circuit inside. So whenever there is a, you know, change in resistance of any arms, because when the vacuum will be created, then this, there is a change, physical changes, that physical change is converted into resistance and resistance will vary. So it means vacuum or pressure is directly proportional to the change in the value of the MAP sensor. Resistance vary, voltage vary. So this change in the physical position is converted into the voltage. For this, we have developed a equation between the pressure versus voltage. Now, for example, now here I can use the pressure here. Now, if you look at the graph, this is between output voltage and pressure. Now, the range of this sensor is generally from 10 kilopascal to 120 kilopascal. The lower limit is around 10 kilopascal, where you can see this is, can I have the crusher or like something like that so that I can display, or I can move the crusher here on this?
Yes.
How? Okay, yeah, now it is coming on. Yeah, I think I can use this. Now this is vacuum. So here the vacuum is, here the pressure is 0 kilopascal, and atmosphere means the pressure is 100 kilopascal. As the pressure increases, the voltage at this point, now I am going to tell you the typical voltage. Here the voltage is around 1.2 volts. As the pressure increases at atmosphere, the voltage may be around 4.2 volts approximately. So it means I am able to judge based on the voltage what is the manifold absolute pressure in the engine. This sensor is mounted, MAP sensor, as name indicate, manifold absolute pressure sensor. So this sensor is mounted on the intake manifold. Sometimes this sensor is mounted on the throttle body also in a very small engines, but the throttle body is because it is connected and mounted on the intake manifold. So basically it measures the absolute pressure inside the intake manifold of the engine. Next come to the TPS, TPS is throttle position sensor. It is a variable potentiometer type sensor. And now there are two types on this. One is the contact type. Suppose I have a resistance, so it is a contact type. I am by the moment I am varying the resistance. The new concept which is coming in the new engines, that is a non-contact type. Because in automotive engine, what is happening? You know, every moment when you are pressing the accelerator pedal, this resistance is varying. So in contact time, frequent contact, going this may cause wear and tear. And after some time, it start misbehaving. So to achieve the high level of durability and accuracy, now we are going to non-contact type, right? But the fundamental is similar. Like you can see, by this I am varying the resistance, right? If I am moving this over this, so resistance will vary and accordingly voltage will vary. Here we can see the characteristics of the TPS. Now again, the good thing is about MAP sensor and TPS is their characteristics is linear in nature. So it is very easy to represent by the equation. You can use the equation y is equal to mx plus c as a straight line, right? So in this TPS, now this position is fully closed. Fully closed means the engine is stationary. You are not pressing the accelerator pedal. Fully closed, right? At this position, the voltage output is generally here. I am talking about this position. So at this position, the voltage is around 0.8 volt. So 0.8 volt is representing throttle position is closed or idle case, idling. Next, when I press the accelerator pedal full throttle, then the position is represented by the fully open position, this, right? And in between position, that will be represented by the relative position of the throttle valve. Voltage here is 0.8 volt. So 0.8 volt is equivalent to idling. And here it is around 4 volt or 4.2 volts. That is equal to wide open throttle. It means your throttle is pressed fully. Accordingly, if it is half open, maybe 2.1 volt, 3 volt, accordingly it can be judged. So this sensor is used to help in calculating the load of the engine, this TPS along with the MAP sensor. Now come to the engine coolant temperature sensor. This is used to measure the temperature of the engine, that is the coolant. Basically, engine temperature is represented by measuring the temperature of the water or coolant which is circulated around the engine, right? Now there are different principles, different type of sensors are available, but in automotive sector we are using NTC type of sensor. These are based on, you know, again, resistance will vary, but NTC means negative temperature coefficient. So means as the temperature increases, the resistance will, temperature increases, resistance will decrease. So here we can just see as the temperature is increasing, this is the characteristic. Now here the temperature is when I have started the engine, it is 25 degrees Celsius. So when this temperature is 25, the resistance is suppose 80 kilo ohm. And when it is heated up 80 degrees Celsius, the resistance has come down. Again, the relationship is somewhat linear, not exactly linear. We have to develop this relationship by adding some resistance and all that. So the characteristics of this, which I have shown, it is theoretical, it is not exactly linear. IAT is also same, ECT based. You know, one important thing, suppose I am measuring the air temperature of the engine, I am measuring the coolant temperature of the engine, and I may be measuring the exhaust temperature of the engine. So as a designer, I should understand first what is the range of the temperature which I am going to measure. Then I have to select the appropriate sensor for that. For engine, the temperature may go up to minus 10, minus 20 if I am running the engine at Leh Ladakh. Like the Gypsy which is produced, they are using in Leh. So the temperature in severe condition is minus 30 degrees Celsius. So it means the sensor which I am using, that should be capable to give the output at minus 30 degrees Celsius. And it should be accurate enough. The maximum temperature, because I have to define the boundary conditions. Even this is true for all type of applications, boundary conditions. Okay, my boundary condition, so practical aspect I take, if it is minus 30, then I took it minus 40. Giving some margin. Then next is maximum temperature of the engine, of the coolant. Do you know how much it can reach? Any idea? It may generally, it should not go more than under 10 degrees Celsius. Generally. If engine is overheated, it may go 120, 130. But safe engine operation is around 110 degrees Celsius, right? So I know minimum side minus 40, maximum side 150 or 140. So I will choose a sensor which is suitable for this range of temperature application. Now come to the air temperature sensor. What can be the temperature of the air? Again, there I have to think about the range, and this sensor, engine coolant temperature sensor, is mounted in the coolant gallery where water is circulated, and this sensor IAT is in the intake manifold. Now we are coming to the crankshaft position sensor. This sensor is, we use different type of, we have either magnetoresistive, we have inductive type, we have Hall effect type of principles. Any sensors can be used, which is rugged, which is stable, which is durable. Now this crank position sensor indicates me the location about the piston, and in identifying the top dead center, when the piston has reached the top dead center. So how we get it, that idea to the ECU? So it is given by the crank position sensor. It gives the position of the piston. It identifies the top dead center. And it also used to calculate the speed of the engine. How to calculate that? That again we will do experimentally on the test bench. Crank position sensor. Again, this is a similar type, Hall effect, magnetoresistive or inductive type. This sensor is mounted on the camshaft. Now here, crank position sensor and cam position sensor, I will elaborate this with the help of the test bench. Why both sensors are used and what is the relationship between crank sensor outcome and cam sensor outcome. Now here, if I would like to emphasize, if from any center there is any query, any questions, you may please ask now, because the sensors, after this I am going to demonstrate on the test bench. so that if there is any question you can put now, and subsequently we can put on the test bench. We will show the outcome of the sensors, the physical shape of the sensor, the location of the sensors, the location of the tooth wheel, and the relationship between the crank and cane position sensor. Because these two sensors, I am telling you, suppose I am using 9 sensor, out of 9 sensor, if IAT is not working, no problem, sir. ECT is not working, no problem. Engine will run, vehicle will run with a 95% accuracy. If MAP is not working, engine will work. If oxygen sensor is not working, engine will work. If crank position sensor or cane position sensor is not working, you cannot drive the car. You cannot run the engine. This is the very basic signal. So the most important and critical sensors are cane position and crank position. So, you know, we have talked a lot about air fuel ratio, right? You understand that? Amount of air, amount of fuel, stoichiometric, rich and lean. And this is what oxygen sensor, we call it also lambda sensor. It is a sensor which measure, which give the idea what is the air fuel ratio going to the engine. That is the idea it is taking. Suppose if it is going rich as per my requirement, then I will make it lean, but I should know what is the air fuel ratio. So oxygen sensor is also known as the feedback sensor. Because suppose I give an example, okay, at 1500 rpm of the engine, when the vehicle is running at 40 km per hour speed, I want a air fuel ratio of 14.6, means lambda should be 1.001. I want that, but how much is that? How I know? This sensor will tell me this is the lambda. Suppose it gives me a value, okay, lambda value is 0.95. It means it is rich. So what I command I will give in my control strategy based on the feedback of the lambda sensor. Okay, now you correct it. You increase the, you reduce the fuel quantity because you have to make it lean. So earlier my pulse width injection duration was suppose 3.8 milliseconds. So it will adjust, it will make it 3.7 or 3.65. Why? So that the targeted lambda value can be met by varying the duration of injection. So this is the purpose of this sensor, and this is heated oxygen sensor. The most difficult part is in the cold condition, this sensor doesn't work. So you will not get what is the air fuel ratio. But this sensor works only when the temperature is around 300 degrees Celsius. So when you are starting in the morning, how you will do? And when we are doing the emissions, you know, Euro 2, Euro 3, Euro 4, do you know there is a driving cycle? When I am testing on the chassis dynamometer, there is a driving cycle. I have to run the car under certain speed and load conditions. First gear 20 km, then 30, then 40, like that. When I am driving that car, at that time I want that oxygen sensor should work in the beginning only, from the idling only. But it will work when the temperature is 300 degrees Celsius. So to avoid that, in during that period I cannot do the correction. To avoid that, recently we have started what is known as heated oxygen sensor. Heated means I have put two more wires. Through the ECU I will give the command that when the, as soon as you ignition on the switch, the current will flow through the heater first, even before cranking. and within few seconds, that is high wattage heater that will heat the oxygen sensor. And when you crank, you will find that the oxygen sensor is working. And this is a very critical sensor. Even, you know, there is a concept of OBD. OBD, you know what is OBD? It is onboard diagnostic system. If there is a problem anywhere in the emissions, fuel economy is poor, then the error should come on the dashboard of the car. So for OBD purpose, again related to the emissions, we are using two oxygen sensors, one for feedback, another for OBD purpose. So that is, you know, next level thing. Today we will discuss only the very basic. So it operates on the principle of a galvanic oxygen concentration cell with electrolyte, that is Nernst principle. For a function, it is necessary to have a temperature of around 300 to 350 degrees Celsius. It depends upon the design to design, but that is a range. Type of oxygen sensor, unheated oxygen sensor, which I told you. For quick warm up, we can use the heated oxygen sensor or preheated oxygen sensor, which is operating at around 12 to 14 volts, battery operated. So this is the material: zirconium, titanium, platinum coated inner and outer surface can also used for this sensor. Oxygen sensor voltage is varying between 0.1 to 0.9 volt. This is the type of signal you can see. If the mixer is rich here, you will get 0.9 volt. If mixer is lean, you will get 0.1 volt. So from rich to lean, lean to rich to lean, it keep on doing like this in a short band. So this is the output of the oxygen sensor. I told you between 0.9 to 0.1 volt. Battery voltage is also given as the input. And now I would like to answer if any person from any sensor has any question related to the sensors. They can raise the question now, because after this I am going to demonstrate on the test bench which we have bring here in the studio. Any question, please? If there is no question, may I go to the test bench? Okay, I hope things are clear to most of the people, and now let I start.
Hello.
Yeah.
From SIT Mathura. All the things are clear, sir. No question.
Yes, please.
The details, no question.
Okay. From any other sensor, from about any sensor, from any center, any question. It means we can go ahead with the demonstration now.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
We are from Pandit Ramadas Jaitiwari College of Polytechnic, Chandoli. We want that you should repeat one sensor, that is IAT sensor. You should. We want to understand it properly.
Very generic question, properly don't define anything. Anyway, that IAT means inlet air temperature sensor. The purpose of this sensor is to measure the temperature of the inlet air which is going to the engine. Now why we use this sensor? Because the density of the air that changes with the temperature. The density of air at NTP is around 1.18. If the temperature is 0 degree Celsius, density of the air will increase. If the temperature is 40 degree Celsius, the density of the air will reduce, and that will change the mass of the air which engine has sucked in. So it is NCT type of temperature sensor. The resistance of this sensor varies according to the temperature. As the resistance varies, voltage also varies. So we are monitoring the voltage and resistance with respect to the temperature, and a relationship is being developed between the temperature and the voltage. Right?
Right, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay, now if there is no question, I would like to go to the test bench.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Sir, we have a question about air fuel ratio.
You want to know about air fuel ratio?
Yes, sir. So my question is that you have told earlier about the various ratios, that petrol is 14.7 and diesel is 14.2. How we can calculate it?
Air fuel ratio, how?
Like for standard for petrol is 14.7, for diesel is 14.2, and for hydrogen is 24.3 something.
So your question is how it is calculated?
Yes, how it is calculated.
Okay. Very simple, very basic. It is the chemistry. The formula of gasoline or petrol is used as, it is CnH2n+2, means C8H18. That is the chemical formula of a gasoline. Approximately, it is not very accurate, but it is approximately, because it depends upon some chemical also, but it is accepted C8H18. So it is a category of alkanes, that is CnH2n+2. So C8H18 multiply by oxygen, it will produce CO2 plus H2O. So I have to balance the equation, and by balancing, then you will calculate how many molecules of oxygen you are reacting with the CH18, and this balancing of this equation will give you the air fuel ratio. Exactly, this will give you the oxygen and fuel ratio. Then you multiply by that 3.71, because in the air oxygen is only 21%, and you calculate the amount of air. And it is very simple calculation. On website, everywhere it is available, in most of the books it is available. So it is based on the chemical equation of the petrol plus oxygen. It is a reactant to product. Balance the reactant and product, you will get the air fuel ratio. Okay. Any question?
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay. The lambda and equivalence ratio are just to use to identify whether the mixture is rich or mixture is lean. That's all. Like oxygen sensor is a lambda sensor, it will indicate what is the lambda value. If lambda is less than 1, mixture is rich. If lambda is more than 1, mixture is lean. Any question from any center? Any question, please? Okay, now I think we can go to the test bench, and if there is any questions, we can answer later on. Now first, I would like to explain the different part of the system. This is a electronic fuel injection test bench, which is fabricated, designed and developed to demonstrate all the different sensors, their location, their counterpart, their associated part. This is the power supply, because most of the sensors, they require 5 volt or 12 volt, so this gives the supply. And then we have the oscilloscope to display different signal and outcome of the different sensor. Now first I would like to start from the crank position sensor. This is the crank position sensor, and this is mounted in front of the crank tooth wheel. This is the crank tooth wheel. You can see the crank tooth wheel, and you can see the different tooth on the crank tooth wheel. The number of tooth, the width of tooth and the height of the tooth is a very important aspect. It is not just we have just make like that. The width, the depth, all is important. Next, number of teeth on the crank tooth wheel is also very critical. In this design which has been created, we have 36 number of teeth. It means in one revolution, there will be 36 pulses, 36 teeth are there. Now, but if I keep regularly 36, I don't know what is the start point. With everywhere it is same, you know. So to avoid that, we miss the teeth. You see, you can see here. There is no teeth here. So this will give me the location in identification of the TDC or any other position, because this gives me a reference. Generally, again it is a strategy of the engine design system. I can use one missing tooth, I can use two. It is my control strategy which is embedded in the ECU. So, but one is a must, rest it is your choice. Now in this, we have used 36 minus 2 minus 2. So two teeth are missing here, two teeth are missing here. So I have 10 here and almost 20 here, 22, 10, 32, 2, 2, 4 are missing. Now this is mounted on the crankshaft of the engine. So this is the crankshaft of the engine. Again, to make the things clear, we have designed a pulley gear also, which is behind this gear, and from this the power is transmitted to the cane gear. What is happening? The engine crankshaft, because it rotates at 1000 rpm, then cane shaft should run at 500 rpm. Means the relationship between crank speed and cane is 2:1. The speed of this will be half. So this design of the gear is prepared accordingly. So number of teeth in this will be less in the crank tooth pulley. Now here you can see the cam truth wheel. So in this cane tooth wheel, we have three teeth equally at 120 degree crank angle, but at one point we have two teeth. Again, this is for the identification, because if I have the three, so I do not know what is the location and difference. And this is my own design. You can design, you can make, okay, I want two, three here, or I want two here, and what is the orientation and location that you can decide. Now please emphasize on these two aspects, because these are very, very important from the engine startability, from the engine running of work. If this sensor working, your ECU detect your engine is running from this sensor only. If this is missing, if this signal is missing, nothing will work. Now you see, we will focus on this. Now I am going to start the this crank and cam tooth pulley, and you can see this is the oscilloscope. Here we are displaying the signal. Now I just you can see the rotation of the crank and cam wheel. Your engine is working in front of you, lab conditions and in real conditions, because the sensors are the same sensor which is used in the car. The output you are getting, the real output, it is not simulated output. The upper yellow line, you can see, even you can, we can count it. There are 36 pulses will be here. You can see number of pulses are more here. And on the bottom side is giving the cane sensor output. I am changing the time scale. You can see this on the oscilloscope. And from these two pulses, we can understand the fundamentals of the relationship between cam and crank. This is why it is important, because I have to detect the TDC, when to inject, how long to inject. So all this calculation is done based on this tool. All the control strategies based on that. Now you can, here I am going to increase, because this is a, I told you, it is like a real engine working. Now I am going to increase the speed of the engine and just watch it on the crank and camshaft pulley. The speed is going to be increased. Now speed is going to be reduced. You need not to fire the engine. Sitting in your lab, sitting in your studio, you can see all the real process, signaling, conditioning and displaying of the output of the sensor. Cycle of the engine, there are two revolutions of the crank. So two revolutions of the crank equal to one revolution of the cam. So here I can see both, then I can match it
that the TDC is like that or not. Now, this time I am again increasing the speed. You see, when I am increasing, here the number of pulses are coming more fast. You can see.
So this will, if once you have done this, most of the your work is done, because these other sensors, they are the supporting sensors, they are just helping in the correction of the signal, correction of the basic duration of injection. Now this sensor, here it is written T-MAP, here in this air temperature and air pressure in the manifold is measured. So earlier we were using two sensors, IAT separately, MAP separately, but to reduce the cost of the sensor, it is integrated in this only. So now we have one sensor because both are mounted on the intake manifold. So I can integrate this and I can mount on the same position in the intake manifold, and I can measure the temperature of the air which is going to the engine, the pressure of the air which is going to the engine. So again this signal will go to the EC. Now come to the next. Here we have discussed engine coolant temperature sensor, ECT. So this sensor is ECT. And the behavior of the sensor is temperature versus resistance and voltage. So this, again this signal will go to the EC and EC will process accordingly. Another sensor is the TPS, throttle position sensor, which is a variable resistance type. You can see the throttle position sensor here. Again this output you can display on the oscilloscope. As you rotate it, there is no more physical movement in this sensor because these are temperature sensitive and all that. So these are very simple and rugged sensors. The most critical part is crank and cane. Now these are the sensor part. Another sensor, lambda sensor. We will just see if I have that. One more important thing I would like to tell you. The sensor which is mounted, the pulse which you have seen, this is Hall effect type sensor. इसमें you are getting the air pulse. Here there is a inductive type of sensor, this one in my hand. In this sensor, if I will put here and if I will rotate the wheel, then I will get the sinusoidal waves. So this sensor is also used. This sensor is also used. So this is the choice of the designer, and it is affected also by the cost. But different engine manufacturers, like Maruti, they use Hall effect or magnetoresistance type. In some cars, like Tata Motors, they use inductive type. But most of the Japanese manufacturers, they use Hall effect type, which I have shown the pulses and output signal of the sensor on the oscilloscope at different state. Now come to the output side. This, all the sensor input will go to the ECU. And why I want to operate? The objective is to operate the injector so that it can inject the appropriate quantity of fuel. The cut section which I have shown, this is the gasoline injector, petrol injector. As I told you, this is a solenoid type. It is 12 volt operated. One is input signal from the ECU. When the circuit is completed, it will on and it will off. The on time of this injector, you can see how precise. There are holes on this nozzle. If you can focus here, you can see the hole here. And these holes are very, very fine. The diameter is much, much less than the 1 mm. Even if you think the technology is not available commonly to make a hole less than 1 millimeter diameter, so these are special techniques are used. Like, so the fuel is atomized from this small jet. And this injector is mounted on the fuel rail, which is this. Now I am mounting you this injector on the fuel rail. This is the seal. Now I am inserting the seal into the gas rail and just inserting the injector. You can see there are two ribs here. This connector and this rib should be aligned perfectly. This ribs and this injector has to be aligned perfectly. You cannot make it like this. You cannot make it like this. And there are pins available, then I will lock it here so that in the vehicle it will not move like this. Another important aspect, it is a multi-point. I have three injectors, 1, 2, and 3, third is in my hand. Again, I am putting this injector in the fuel rail. Practically, when I am doing this to mount in the engine, I am using a special type of gel over this. Because it micro size of dust will be here, it may cause the leakage. No dust is allowed on this seal. This is a very special seal. So I am using that silica gel. Then after using the silica gel, I am inserting this in the fuel rail. Now you can see the three injectors are mounted on the fuel rail. This fuel rail may be made of aluminium, that is a pressure die casting, or gravity die casting, or it may be plastic also. Next important part is pressure regulator. This is the pressure regulator. The pressure used in the intake manifold, this is mounted on the fuel rail. Fuel is coming from this side, from the fuel tank. Fuel will come, enter into the gas rail, the fuel rail, and the excess quantity of fuel will be returned from this line back to the tank. Because when the engine is at idling, fuel requirement is very, very low. So fuel is very high in volume, in amount. So rest of the fuel will go back, and this pressure regulator, this side, is connected to the vacuum of the intake manifold. So there is a diaphragm in this which will operate and maintain the pressure around 2.9 kgf per centimeter square or 290 kilopascal. That is, the pressure is being maintained in the pressure regulator. Excess fuel will return. When the ECU will give a command, the injector will operate, which will switch on the injector, and fuel is injected from the tip of the injector. You have seen that. Now, another important aspect, now I am going to tell you, this type of injector, they are known as saturated injector. They consume around 2 ampere of current and they are operating at 12 volts. But you have seen vehicles running on gas also, CNG also, LPG also. In that, I cannot use this injector. For that, to show you, I have gas injector. Now, this is the gas injector and this is the gas rail. CNG will come enter from here and pressure regulator is before the gas rail, and there are three injectors. This is the outlet, because gas, now why this is like this? You can see in petrol it is very fine hole, but in gas it is not fine. Why? Can you tell me? Pardon? Good. Gas is already in gas form. I need not to atomize that. There I need very fine, because it is a, I have to convert that liquid into liquid droplet and liquid droplet into very fine vapors to make it in the gas form. But here already it is in gas. So that's why here I can put a nozzle of a size maybe 1 millimeter, 1.8 millimeter, 2.3 millimeter depending upon the size of the engine. So this is mounted on the near the intake manifold. From here, the nozzle will go to the intake manifold. One nozzle will go to cylinder number 1, next cylinder number 2, next cylinder number 3. Similarly, this is for cylinder number 1, cylinder number 2 and cylinder number 3. It means this gas rail is suitable for 3 cylinder engine. Now this is the fuel side. I told you there are two sides. One is the mixture preparation, which was done by the carburetor. Now it is done by the electronic injection system. The duration of this injection may be varying from 2 milliseconds to 18 milliseconds, depending upon the load and speed of the engine. Now come to the another part, that is ignition. You can see here, we call it a integrated coil. This coil is directly mounted on the engine near the cylinder, and here you can see a spark plug. This is the spark plug. When I show spark plug, people think, okay, it is spark plug, but it is a technology behind it. Even in India, we are not able to produce this spark. It is a technology. You can see this side, it is called side electrode. And in the center you can see that is called central electrode. And there is a gap between central and side electrode. And this gap is very important. Can you guess generally what is the gap in your car, spark plug, in the spark plug of your motorcycle. Do you have any idea? The gap between the spark, everybody directly or indirectly is using engine. Everybody is using. But everybody is not thinking about the concepts. The gap between the spark plug electrode is around 0.8 millimeter. It plus minus I give a tolerance of 0.1 mm. Even you can do lot of research at PhD in varying the gap. There are PhD on this. There are maybe 100 papers on this. Research paper published in journals. But if you look at, okay, the cost is 100 rupees of spark plug. Okay. Again, same thing. Apple is fallen. How you perceive that? Spark plug is there. How to see it? जैसे वो निशाना लगाया था उसने अर्जुन ने उससे पूछा भाई आप क्या देख रहे हो पेड़ पे बोला सर सभी ने कहा सर मैं पेड़ देख रहा हूँ एक चिड़िया देख रहा हूँ सर मैं एक टहनी देख रहा हूँ उसमें ग्रीन लीव्स हैं और उसके बीच में एक चिड़िया बैठी हुई है फिर किसी ने कहा सर मैं उसकी टांगे भी देख रहा हूँ पर भी देख रहा हूँ और अर्जुन ने कहा सर मेरे को तो चिड़िया की आँख दिख रही है और मुझे कुछ से नहीं दिख रहा तो नजरिया है सिर्फ देखने का तो ये स्पार्क प्लग अब ये नजरिया ही यू कैन डू एंड यू कैन डू एक्सपेरिमेंट बाय वेयरिंग दिस गैप हाउ इट इफेक्ट्स योर फ्यूल इकोनॉमी हाउ इट विल इफेक्ट योर पावर ऑफ द इंजन हाउ इट इफेक्ट योर एमिशंस ऑफ द इंजन हाउ And why it affects? If I will increase the gap, why it is affecting? Why? So, my dear friends, 3W1H is the concept, basic concept behind learning. 3W means why, when, where. And one that is how. When this question arises in your mind, you will start thinking upon those and you will try to get an answer for that. And it will make the matters more interesting for you. So this ignition coil, it produces approximately 25,000 volts. Battery in the car is 12 volt battery, but this is capable to produce 25,000 volts minimum. It may be 30 or 35,000 volts also. How it is produced? Again, it is a technology. How it is controlled? Again, it is in there. So this high voltage, when it is passing through the central electrode and the side electrode is grounded, it creates a path. If I will give you 12 volt, do you think spark will occur? No. If 1000 volts, no. I can give more and more wider gap if I have a more voltage. Wider the gap, more you see the very fine thing. More the gap, more will be the air and fuel ratio which will come in contact in this region between the electrodes. And the intensity of the combustion will be more. If the gap will be less, you will not be able to come between the two gaps. So this gap is significant meaning. Another meaning, I am just touching upon, I will not go in detail. Even the height of this ground electrode, side electrode, it may be here, it may be even like this. It is also important. We call it protrusion. In this spark plug, you are able to see only one ground electrode. There may be two, one from this side, one is this, like this. And there may be four also. So this is the design aspect of the spark. But this is most commonly used and very cheap also. So in this, we have covered the ignition system. Ignition coil. Basically, for display purpose, I have used only one ignition coil. You can use three ignition coil for three cylinder, three spark plug, three injector for three cylinder, pressure regulator, throttle position sensor, temperature sensor, manifold absolute pressure sensor, engine coolant temperature sensor, aim position sensor, crank position sensor, crank tooth wheel, aim tooth wheel, relationship between crank and aim, relationship between crank speed and aim speed, and the importance of top dead center, ignition timing and injection timing. That all can be demonstrated on this test bench. Now, I would like to ask and answer any question which you have in your mind. So, if anybody has any questions, you would like to discuss that. From any center, any questions from any center? Yes, please. Yes, please. Okay. Multiple electrodes, why we should use, when we should use. Basically, the researcher realized that when I am making the mixture lean, it improves the fuel economy. Lean burn engines are known to produce very good mileage and very good mileage and very low NOx, because you make very lean, NOx will also reduce, CO will also reduce and fuel economy will also improve. So, but the combustion initiation, the starting of the lean is very difficult. Because if it will be more and more air, so combustion is, firing is difficult. Then how to improve the firing? There are two things for that. Number one, you can use high energy ignition system. That ignition coil should be capable to produce 20 to 30,000 or 40,000 volts. Another thing, I can use a multi-electrode spark plug. Like it is like that, you are igniting, you have a matchstick, you are burning two or three matchstick at a time. So that mixture is lean, it can catch fire quickly and easily. So that is the purpose behind usage of the multi-electrode spark plug. They are useful only in lean burn engine, which are operating at an air fuel ratio of about 20:1. There the utilities may be there. Even in petrol engine, you can use that to enhance the performance of the engines. Hello. Yes, please.
Hello.
Yes.
In case of IC engines, sensors is put on a ghost pipe. So what is the life of such a sensor?
May I also tell me which type of sensor is mounted on the exhaust pipe?
You were just telling that some sensor is put on a ghost pipe.
No, it is correct, but I want to know which type of sensor is mounted on the exhaust pipe. Which sensor?
The type, I don't know.
Okay, now I am going to tell you first, we are mounting the exhaust sensor on the exhaust pipe. That is one thing. It is also known as lambda sensor. And the life of the exhaust sensor, because even the operation start at 350 degrees Celsius and we are using noble metal in that is platinum and like that. So the life is even much better than the any other sensors, because it is designed for that. So absolutely no problem about the life, about the durability, about the accuracy or the period of the vehicle of the life. Any other question, please?
In Indian vehicles, we use both gas and petrol fuel in same units without any change in the injectors. How do they work?
No. In CNG vehicle, like there are two type of system basically. In cars, we call it bi-fuel vehicle, means the car can operate either on petrol. If petrol is not available, either on CNG. They cannot operate both at a time. So for CNG, spark plug remains same, but we have to mount either the gas carburetor or we have to mount the gas injector in that separately. And even gas ECU is also separately. So in a car, you have the ECU for the petrol injector, you have the ECU for the, we call it master slave ECU for the gas CNG, and we have the different type of injector which are used for the CNG. It is not the same injector. Ignition spark plugs are same and most of the sensors are also same to reduce the cost. But in addition to that, we are using gas temperature sensor and gas pressure sensor.
One more question.
Yes.
In household entity pleasure, sensor composition is more suitable for vehicles with the setting part is burden effect on the vehicle.
For LPG?
In household LPG pleasure, sensor composition is not suitable for vehicles.
Precisely, it is not suitable, but it can run. You can run your car on LPG which is used for domestic purpose, because it is a fuel, but it will not give you the optimum life of your engine and optimum fuel economy, because the purity of that gas is not up to the mark. But engine will run, your car will run, emissions may not be very good, life of the engine may not be very good. The auto LPG which is also sold in the station, that is meant for the cars, that is good fuel, it is filtered well because it has to go into the combustion chamber. Domestic LPG you have to just burn in the burner, so there is no worry about the combustion. But in a passenger car engines, there are concerned about the combustion. However, because LPG is a fuel, so it can be used in the car also, but that is not, you know, desirable.
Sir,
and
what,
what
is the difference between Bharat Stage 3 and Bharat Stage 4 as per emission norms?
Bharat, may you repeat please?
What is the difference between Bharat Stage 3 and Bharat Stage 4 related to emission norms? Euro 3 and Euro 4.
Okay. I think I have shown you the slide also. I can take you on that slide again. In Bharat Stage 3 and 4, there is a change in the value of the CO and HC and NOx. All are reduced, maybe from 20% to 40%. That I can show you exactly. Like HC is reduced almost half. In Bharat Stage 3, it was 0.2 gram per kilometer, whereas in Bharat Stage 4, it is 0.1 gram per kilometer. CO is reduced from 2.3 gram per kilometer to 1.0 gram per kilometer. And NOx is 0.15 to 0.08. It means you can say there is a more or less 50% reduction in the emissions between Bharat Stage 3 and 4. Is it clear? Next
yes,
question.
Yes.
Next. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
My pleasure. Yes. Any question from any other center?
Excuse me. I want to ask one question. That with CNG, better fuel efficiency is obtained, but some bad effects are also observed on the engine. What are the major
guide effects on the engine, the CNG users? CNG, no doubt CNG in terms of kg, because you are getting the CNG in terms of kg. So 1 kg of CNG has the more calorific value than the 1 liter of petrol. That is one thing. If you take in terms of kg also in petrol, then there is not, the gap will reduce, you know, but still the CNG has a better efficiency because of the higher calorific value and higher octane number. Now, advantage is better fuel economy. Disadvantage is, if the engine is not designed properly, the flame propagation, the combustion of the CNG is slow. Means, if you burn the CNG, it will, the combustion will be slow because of the characteristics of the CNG. The flame speed is slow. I have shown you the graph of the flame speed. The flame speed is slow. It burns slowly. Petrol burns faster. So what happened due to this? CNG engine, the heat is more transferred to the engine in the combustion chamber. And if the radiator is not designed properly, engine may overheat, which will reduce the life of the engine, number one. Number two, CNG fuel is a dry fuel. It is not a liquid fuel. So when the petrol is injected in the engine, it vaporizes. It gives a cooling effect in the combustion chamber. Because engine is already running very hot. So it will cool down that. But CNG is dry. There is no lubricant in that. And it's dry. So engine CNG is has a little bit dry operation. Lubrication, lubricity is less. So wear and tear of the CNG engine is slightly more. Two. Now third point is, when I am using the CNG, the temperature is, because higher in the combustion chamber, the engine valves, piston rings, they are designed to cater the petrol. CNG valves, to cater the high temperature, you are used to different alloying elements. So if we take care of those things, the engine durability can be also increased. But anyway, because the engine are basically designed for the petrol, and the same engine is used for the CNG application, so it is never giving the optimum performance and optimum durability. So you have to sacrifice around 10 to 15% life of the engine when you are running on the CNG. Yes, any other question?
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yeah, any question, please?
Sir, in the DIO, IDI, when fuel is injected through the nozzle?
In?
Sir, in the DIO, IDI, when fuel is injected through the nozzle, due to floating, throttling process, certain quality temperature takes place of the charge.
Now, in what you say in DI and in IDI?
When fuel is injected through the nozzle or injector due to throttling process, certain fall in temperature takes place of the charge.
Mm-hmm.
In the region, how it affects the efficiency or performance of the engine?
Actually, that when the fuel is injected, it is good, because when it is injected into the combustion chamber. There the temperature is more than 150 degrees Celsius. Engine is overheated or well heated. So when I am injecting the fuel, that droplet, they absorb the heat. They need the heat from the environment to vaporize. So if it is already heated environment, the vaporization is good, and it is even good for petrol engine also and in the diesel engine also. It is even for the betterment of the performance basically. This may have some problem only in the morning when the startability is there, because at that time engine is cool, so at that time it may be a concern. And in some engine, that's why we are using the heater, so that it can warm the combustion chamber inside the air and it can vaporize the fuel easily. Otherwise, there is no adverse effect of this injection except in the cold starting.
Falling temperature matter or no?
It improves the volumetric efficiency of the engine in case of petrol engine. It is better. There is no adverse effect of falling of the temperature. Any other question, please? Okay, then you can continue to express little bit some, we around some 15 minutes. So now we will proceed little bit further. So I will just summarize you that yes, any question?
Excuse me, sir. Plants of various numbers comes in the market. Is there significance about the consumption of food?
No, may you repeat? Your question is not clear to me.
M market, various numbers of plants are found. Is there any significance by heat produced by the engine? Excuse me.
Yeah, please.
Coolants of various numbers comes in market. Is there any significance by heat produced by the engine?
Anybody understand the question? No, we are not able to understand your question. Please repeat it.
सर कई तरीके के कूलेंट्स अवेलेबल है मार्केट में गाड़ी में यूज होता है अलग अलग नंबर्स के कूलेंट तो उसमें जो प्रोड्यूस होता है उससे कोई रिलेशन है
सर व्हाइल आस्किंग योर क्वेश्चन प्लीज मेंटेन लिटिल डिस्टेंस फ्रॉम माइक माइक
सर डिस्टेंस अगेन लाउड
एक्सक्यूज मी सर मैं कूलेंट्स कम मार्केट ऑफ वेरियस नंबर्स इज देयर एनी सिग्निफिकेंस बाय द हीट प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय द इंजन
Not able to understand your question. Please write your question in chat box so that we can read your question.
Chat box, darling.
Sir, I think there is a sound problem, so. We will ask this question tomorrow, sir. Thank you.
No, sir. Just ask once again. We'll try to understand your question.
Sir, there are various coolants available in market. Various number, many number लिखे हुए आते हैं. So that is related to the heat produced by the engine. Or we can use any type of coolant in our engine, in our car.
Excuse me, if your question is related to the coolant available in the market, different coolants available in the market, and what is the impact of those coolants on the engine performance, is your question is like this?
Yes, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. The I'm sorry because that there was a significant disturbances in the voice. I was not able to hear, but I just guess. I think if this is the your question, I would like to answer this questions. And the answer is that first we should understand why we use coolant. We are using the coolant to increase the amount of heat the engine can carry from the combustion chamber and maintain the temperature of the engine in severe summer conditions, and this is done because the boiling temperature of the water is 100 degree Celsius. So I am adding certain amount of chemicals which enhance the boiling point of that coolant, which is around 130 degree Celsius. So that adding that chemical will not allow the water to boil, because there is again a ratio between water and that that additives. So that temperature may be around 130 degree Celsius. So more heat can be carried out without boiling the water. That is one purpose. Second purpose is water freezes at 0 degree Celsius. if I am in cold winter, the water may frozen inside the vehicle. To avoid that, again that additive is added, that coolant into the water, which reduce the freezing point of water, and that make it around minus 30 degrees Celsius. So up to minus 30, the coolant will not freeze, and so the the temperature range of the coolant has changed from 0 to minus 30, 100 to plus 130. So that is the objective behind this. Now, if there are different coolants available in the market, I am not sure what will be their composition. If they are not able to meet these characteristics, then it will affect the performance of the engine, especially in the summer and in the winter. Another thing, we are adding anti-rust also in that, so that because water or that coolant is circulating all around the engines, so there should not be any rust and any scaling in that passage of the water. So that is also avoided. So if it is not a standard coolant, surely it will affect the performance and life of the engine. So my suggestion is always go with the coolant which is recommended by the OEM. Okay.
There is one more question.
Yes, please.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Sir, in petrol engines, equation is CAHAT. How can you balance this equation to find out A ratio F?
I think if you go to an SAE website, even this equation is sold. And you can find out it is a very simple thing, because you have to just balance. If you can balance CH4 plus oxygen like CO2 plus 2H2O, so we can balance this also. That is absolutely no problem. You have to find out some coefficient, and it can be done easily. Even if you face any problem, go to the SAE website, which is Society of Automotive Engineers. They are substandard, which calculate the which help you in calculating the air fuel ratio for any fuels. Equation is given and balancing is given. Even you can find out in any SAE handbook also. Okay. Any question, please, from any center? So can we go a little ahead?
Yes.
Okay. Now we have discussed a lot about the air fuel mixing, rich, lean, stoichiometric. Now fuel may be rich, air fuel ratio may be lean, air fuel ratio may be stoichiometric. Now when I am igniting that, I need certain amount of energy to ignite. That ignition energy is known as spark energy or ignition energy. This is the energy which is given by the high voltage, which is converted, produced by the ignition coil and a spark plug. Now if you can see this graph, if I have lambda or equivalence ratio 1, then ignition energy requirement is very low, relatively. If we are using the mixture lean, again it is increasing. If I am making it very rich, again it is increasing. So that's why somebody asked why the multi-electrode spark plug. So if I want to operate, because sometimes if I want to produce very high power, this racing car, they use rich mixture. So they also require high energy ignition system. And the fuel economy improvement, when you need, there also you need high energy ignition system to burn that. Oh, very important aspect I am now touching upon. When to start injection, when to start ignition. So this is more a design aspect, but I will superficially I will touch upon this. Injection I should start when the inlet valves, after the inlet valve opening. And spark I should start during the compression stroke when the piston is at TDC, just before that I should start the spark. You can see here. It is sort of a TDC point, this one. Now if I am making, you can see the lower curve in the upper graph, this curve. Here my ignition timing I have kept 10 degree before TDC. So I am igniting, I am spark creating the spark at 10 degree before top dead center. So you see the power produced, peak pressure produced is very low. Only this much, only maybe 12 or 13 megapascal. And if I am making it 30 degree advance, the cylinder pressure increases. Cylinder pressure increases means more power, more torque. And if I am making 50 degree advance, you can see the pressure is increasing significantly. So when, if I want more power and more torque, I have to advance the ignition timing. But when I am advancing the ignition timing, NOx also increases. So I have to balance both the things. So that is called calibration. I have to do it. And this is the MBT. You know what is MBT? MBT, minimum advance for best torque. Minimum advance for best torque. This is here. So I will advance till I get the best torque, best pickup, best power. So this is the strategy while optimizing the ignition timing. And when to ignite, it is done by the ECU. And that is a strategy. When to do, how to do, all these things by the control strategy. That is done in the firmware. Just to give the background, now I have shown you the, this is called DLI system. DLI means this is a distributorless ignition system. Earlier we have a distributor, you see, suppose there is a four cylinder engine, so this is a distributor, these are the four leads, 1, 2, 3, 4, like you can see the four spark plug, like 1, 2, 3, 4, like. So there was one ignition coil that was connected to the distributor, and that distribute the ignition energy to the cylinder number 1, 2, 3, and 4 at appropriate time. But the disadvantage of the system was it don't have the higher ignition energy. So that's why this system is now obsoleted. Why obsoleted? Because they cannot, their output voltage is around 10 to 15,000. Now we are using 30 to 40,000 volts. And that was not possible with this system. So this is again different sensor. So with this, I think exact 4 o'clock, yeah. So we have planned till 4 o'clock and today, now in next few minutes I can summarize. We have discussed about the engine management system, fundamental of the engines, air fundamental requirement of the engine. So we learned, I just summarize, we learned that air is more fundamental requirement, like a human being engine is also, you know, power, torque, fuel economy depend upon the air, not on the only fuel. It's the more air is the more fundamental. Then we understand about the composition of the air, then air fuel ratio requirement, different speed, different load condition requirement, different air fuel ratio. If air is more, it is lean. If air is less, it is rich. And if it is chemically balanced, it is stoichiometric. And you can practice for the calculating the air fuel ratio for different fuels. There are equations available for that. It is simple mathematical equations of chemistry. Then we learned about the engine management system. Earlier we were using the carburetor. Why carburetor was obsoleted? Because it was not able to provide the precise control of the fuel. Then the technology switched over to meet the BS2, BS3, BS4 emissions norm, that is known as electronic fuel injection system. And with electronic fuel injection system, it consists of air intake system. Then it consists of fuel system, fuel pump, fuel filter, fuel injector. Then we talk about the sensors. There are different sensors, crank position sensor, cam position sensor, engine coolant temperature sensor, inlet air temperature sensor, manifold absolute pressure sensor. And then we talk about the oxygen sensor. Then there are other sensors also like vehicle speed sensors. And then that high end is you have the NOx sensor, you have the misfiring sensors and all that we have not touched upon, because they are little bit in the high end cars. So this is the sensor. Then all the sensor principle of their working, their importance, their location has been discussed. Then all the sensor we try to demonstrate on the electronic fuel injection test bench. We understand the relationship between crank and cam speed, the relationship between the crank angle and the cam angle, the number of teeth, the teeth profile play an important role. Even the gap between the sensor and the tooth wheel is a important, generally we are keeping it around 0.8 mm to 1.2 mm. If it is more, then we cannot get the appropriate strength of the signal, and if it is too close, then it may damage the tooth. And in automobile application, you can feel when the car is jumping and all that. So this is very, you know, stability of this sensor integration is very important. Then we understand what is the basic duration of injection. Then temperature, air temperature, coolant temperature, altitude compensation, because fuel requirement changes as per the temperature and atmospheric pressure. That compensation is also considered into this. So that is a correction factor which we are integrating. Then we learn about the ignition system, what type of ignition system, how the spark plug gap is important, and then what type of ignition coil is there, distributorless, what is the range of the secondary voltage, that we learn. And then we understand that about some question about the CNG and LPG. CNG is CNG injection system. We don't have the small nozzle and all that because atomization is not important there. It is more important in the gasoline and all that. So then we also learned that CNG calorific value is much higher than the petrol. That's why it gives the average. But you have to redesign the engine to take care of the heat balance. And with this, I think I thanks to all the participants for bearing the patience in listening me, and secondly, I hope that few questions will be more in their minds, which may be answered tomorrow if there is any questions. And otherwise also I will give my email address if any question is there later on. The questions can be answered through emails also. And tomorrow what we will do, we will start in the morning around I think 9:30. So first tomorrow I will touch upon some little bit theoretical aspect of emissions, combustion and emissions control technology. And in the morning session only, first I would like to give a demonstration of the emissions control technology, like what we have given in the electronic fuel injection system. So we will have the technology display for that also tomorrow. That is a diesel particulate filter. I will show you the, what is diesel particulate filter, what is the active regeneration system, and what is the EGR valve, and how this mechanism controls and works. So those will be the practical aspect of the tomorrow that I was planning actually, so that we will do in the morning. So we will focus so that when you will see the system and all that, you may have more questions and you can learn much better. So that we will try in the morning. And if now if any question is there, you may ask those questions. I would like to answer those questions. If there is no questions, you please revise whatever has been learned today, because by listening one time will not serve the purpose. It is the practice which you have to do and which you have to think upon, and you have to inculcate in your habits, the learning habits, because today the pace of the technology is increasing, that is much more faster than the what we are being taught in the classrooms. We are talking about now Euro 5, and classrooms are even still teaching Euro 2 or like that technology. So there is a gap between 8 to 10 years between the teaching and between the industries. So I can see that gap. I am trying to bridge that gap, being with Maruti, being with FEV Germany, being with IIT Delhi. So I am able to visualize what is being even in IIT. I can compare with IIT syllabus. Even IIT are behind 5 to 6 years, in the syllabus and all that. So there is a time to fill this gap, but their faculties are more aware about the advancement and all that. So without book, they are able to give to their students what is going on latest. But most of the engineering colleges, they go by the book's knowledge. So always it creates the gap between the classroom teaching and the technology what industry is using. So we are trying to bridge this gap. And this is the electronic fuel injection system which we have displayed. This is meant for training. If any institute is willing to have this, even they can take my address. We will give the tomorrow our email address also. So any lab, any want, like it can be used. We can prepare for this type of test bench, because we have given to IIT, we are talking to IIT Delhi, with some other engineering college. They like this idea, even including some industry like Honda and TVS Motors. They want this type of system because this make the clear fundamental. You can do lot of experiments. Even you can do with this, how you can calculate the engine speed, because this wheel is rotating, number of teeth are counted, but what is the formula you are using to calculate the speed? What is the formula you are using to start identify the start of injection? What type of, how you are detecting the TDC? All these things you can learn by doing some experiments on this. You can see the spark, because it is actually actuator. If you connect the fuel line injector, you can see the spray also. You can do everything on this test bench. So if anybody is interested to have and to learn more, so he is also always welcome. And with this word, I thanks all of you again, and I thanks NITTRI to give us the opportunity to interact with all of you, and hope tomorrow session we will again come with the new concept on combustion and emissions control technology. Thanks. By now, if any question is there, please let me know, otherwise we can close the session.